Dr. Don Behem, a community access television producer and the host of an ongoing weekly cable television series, Conversations with Dr. Don. I'm also a retired clinical psychologist and a certified Creole, born and raised in New Orleans, Louisiana. The program you're about to watch, one of a series of 16 or so individual broadcasts, came about because I wanted to record and share with you highlights of the 2007 Creole Heritage Celebration in the beautiful and historic city of Natchitoches in northwest Louisiana. I wanted to do this because I'd heard good things about this organization of Creoles from a number of sources. An organization that tracks the Creole diaspora? When I grew up in New Orleans in the 30s and 40s, I knew of no formal organization of Creoles like the Creole Heritage Foundation of today. I only knew of the local, more or less, neighborhood social organizations like the Autocrat Club in New Orleans. Well, like so many young Creoles in the 40s, returning from military service to other parts of the country, I lost touch to a large degree with the New Orleans Creole-style community. Now, the city of Los Angeles Creole community in the 50s through the 70s provided a modicum of Creole community, but nothing like the Creole community in New Orleans in the 30s and 40s. And then moving out of Los Angeles proper into the larger Los Angeles area suburban community further isolated me from my cultural upbringing, not to mention moving to Oregon 13 years ago. Ever find yourself in a place where you see someone that has a look or a flavor about them that suggests that they might be a Creole or a whatever, only to discover that it is more how they look physically that caused your misperception? Yeah. Of course, I love where I live now in the rainy Pacific Northwest, but if there are any Creoles up here, I haven't seen any. So that's why I decided that I had to come to the celebration. And I'm so very glad I did. I can't put into words the feelings of joy and connection that I felt at the celebration and am still feeling today. That feeling of joy and connection was certainly encouraged and facilitated by the warm and gracious welcome and ongoing support and assistance of Mrs. Janet Rabaray Coulson, the executive director of the NSU Creole Heritage Center, and her eager, dedicated staff. I can't thank Mrs. Coulson and her staff enough. I believe that the flavor and essence of what it's like to be Creole comes through in the speeches and presentations that you will see and hear in the series of broadcasts that comprise the complete program. I believe that whether or not you are Creole, you are bound to learn more about us, our heritage, and our love of life. I hope that after viewing any or all of this series of programs, you viewers might become encouraged to find more of the fun and love of life in your own particular culture. So, enough of my talk, and on with the program.
Based on actual events and experiences from Poikapay Parish and Louisiana. I'm humbled and honored, actually, for the opportunity here at the Creole Heritage Celebration to bring this story home to Louisiana before it's released to the broader public in the future. My personal journey to retrace the footsteps of the past of our ancestors brought me back to the founding days of the Louisiana colony. A native New Orleanian, now residing in Colorado, the experience learning about the remarkable history of Louisiana through our ancestors, who were the first to arrive and settle de la Louisiane, from the far reaches of New France, Europe, and Africa, together with those native people already inhabiting the region, has been life-changing, and I'm sure for each of you. Each bit of knowledge precipitated curiosity to understand more and to stitch together the threads of time for Louisiana, a relatively unknown facet of history today. A decade ago, I changed careers from small business consulting and commercial real estate brokerage to that of a historian, founding Creole West Productions, to liberate this remarkable history through edutainment projects. Always enthralled by what seemed to be mystical stories about Poikapay and Louisiana's past from my centenarian Creole elders, the journey brought the history alive to this otherwise city gal from New Orleans, opening my horizons to the fascinating family and times in the country at Poikapay. A remark by my then 12-year-old nephew living in Indiana while working on his biography project on Albert de Quer from Poikapay for National History Day made an indelible effect on the process of my work. When he shared with his teacher the topic of his biography, she encouraged him to do a project on someone more famous. Peter quickly exclaimed, "You don't have to be famous to be important." His words have been my impetus to tell the story of those from our past, not so famous, who have shaped all our lives. History belongs to all of us because it is created by all of us. This project was inspired by actual events and experiences of extraordinary heroines and heroes of Poikapay and Louisiana. As pioneers in their early struggles for civil rights, their actions shaped the foundations for civil rights in the United States and paved the path for each of us today. Initially considered as a nonfiction documentary project, it all changed last fall while I was examining the 1868 voter registration record at the Poikapay Parish Courthouse. I'm only the storyteller, nothing really any more remarkable than putting it all pen to paper and sharing the story. You all, community, are part of this history. Let me set up the story and its historical time period. The historical foundation is based on actual events and experiences. An author draws a fine line moving from nonfiction to fiction. I believe that line lies in the area of respect for those we base our novels. It's not important today to know exactly who the people were, but their experiences. As we weren't there, we can only imagine their actual experiences, thoughts, and motivations. As a result, the characters have fictitious names and are developed how I imagine them to be, what they would feel and say. The complete novel covers the historical period of Louisiana and American history from the early 18th century up to about the late 1890s. The story is told by Creole Georges Jacques, whose parents were some of the early African slaves brought to the Louisiana colony with the Company of the Indies on behalf of the King of France. Georges was born in 1768, a Creole born in the Louisiana colony, at a time when France had transferred all her colonial possessions in North America to England and Spain. This episode this morning brings us historically to the time immediately after the war between the states, also known as the Rebellion, and the American Civil War, and ends in 1868. freed from President Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation, in his late 90s, Creole Jean-Jacques reminds us that anything is possible as he takes the milestone step toward privileges as a free American man. The story begins, A Visit to Nanan, Fall, 1960. The long, hot, humid season had passed. The aroma of sugarcane fields were burning in the distance, exuding the familiar sweet smell of concentrated molasses and ash. It brought cooler weather, and it was that time of year to visit Nanan again in New Orleans. We always looked forward to the visits. Mama packed fresh baked goods in a big basket, chess pie squares, tea cookies, sweet potato pies, and plawrines. Nanan would have our Creole pot roast dinner simmering in her little gas oven when we arrived. We boarded the bus for New Orleans. I was clenching the basket of baked goodies like a pot of gold. It was a day-long ride with many stops from upriver, the country, and usually no seats left in the back of the bus by the time we got on. Almost always we stood the entire trip. We'd made this trip many times, too many to count. This trip in 1960 stands out. A few stops later, a young girl and an elegant elder lady boarded the bus. Very well dressed, the lady was in hat and gloves, clutching a beautiful purse and umbrella. The little girl wore a fine department store dress and shoes with matching bow in her hair. The lady looked and acted like the very classy Miss Cammie back home who Mama cooked for. The girl ran up the front steps of the bus and skipped onward past where we stood. The lady quickly pulled the little girl back and immediately guided her to the front seat behind the bus driver. In a fit of defiance, the little girl, about 5 years old, pulled away and told the lady, I want to sit in the back to see where we can stretch out and see everything. The lady quietly yet sternly whispered to her, but we could hear as we were standing nearby, No. That is for Negroes only. Hands on her hips, swinging her ponytail in frustration, she exclaimed, Grandma, why do they get the best seat on the bus? Not answering, the grandmother gracefully nudged her into the front seat next to the window behind the bus driver and protectively sat close behind her granddaughter. All of us standing behind heard what she said. Mama gave me that special look with her smiling eyes and whispered in Creole, from the mouth of the bebés. We knew that little girl's simple, naive question had no simple response. When we got onto New Orleans and finally arrived at our final stop, Canal Street, the street was beautifully lit up with all the signs of the stores and movie theater marquees and the tall, flickering street-lined gas lamps. It was quite a sight always. Only few blocks to walk, and we'd be there. It had begun to rain a bit when we approached the city. When we stepped off the bus, as Mama was struggling to open her umbrella, I immediately noticed Uncle Pierre and his car waiting for us. As we scurried to his car to keep dry, more so our basket of goodies, I noticed the little girl and her grandmother walk toward a beautiful new convertible. The top wasn't open since it was raining. Then the little girl ran past her grandmother, jumped into the arms of a well-dressed man with a fine hat, just like in the movies. She smiled so big when he stepped out of the car, we could see her missing two front teeth. He must have been her daddy. It was a short drive. Nanan was waiting, dressed always like she was ready to meet the queen. She was widowed. Grandfather died 10 years before. She was the last of her siblings, but a mother to 10 children, 42 grandchildren, and a growing number of great-grandchildren. Most of us were still in the country where our family had been since the early 1700s. A few of my aunts and uncles and their families lived nearby Nanan. She was so fond of the city and his joie de vivre. She lived in her house near Canal Street. They'd owned it since the 1880s. It wasn't easy for her to come up river at 100, so we would all come down to visit her. The double camelback shotgun house was always immaculate, as were her gardens. Uncle Pierre had just repainted the house a month before and restored it to its brilliant Creole blue, like he matched the paint to the hibiscus in her garden. Inside was like a museum, with things that had been in our family forever. In particular was a china cabinet with glass doors and an inside light that would illuminate all the beautiful china, crystal, and sterling silver pieces. She had beautiful furniture, clocks, my great-grandfather's library of books in French and English, an old Victrola, and all their old French opera records. Nanan loved to sit down after we ate and answer all of our questions about history and the ancestors. She'd always encourage us to ask questions, reminding each of us, curiosity is a sign of intelligence. This day I didn't know if I had one question or a million, but I couldn't forget what that little girl said on the bus. Of all the things Nanan had in her antique curio cabinet, I was drawn today to something odd I noticed standing behind an old French book, The Three Musketeers by Alexandre Dumas. I moved the book aside and found an old writing instrument with a worn wooden handle and a gold-looking tip. Why would Nanan have kept this old writing instrument? Nanan answers, "You have just found the key to our past, our most valuable family heirloom, something that must be kept in the family always. I must tell you our story. It was over 90 years ago, almost to the day, that your great-grandfather, Georges Jacques, was given this pen. This story has been told to each generation. Listen carefully, as you'll need to pass it on, too. It takes us back to an October day in the country of South Louisiana in 1868. The long summer's heat and steamy air was beginning to wane. The blistering heat of the day was breaking. The nights were beginning to get cooler and drier. It was harvest season, sugar cane and cotton. This time of year, the sky was a brilliant blue, the gentle breeze causing the ripples on the water to sparkle like diamonds in the sun. The cane harvest was in full swing. The air was filled with a sweet and smoky smell of burning cane. You could hear a choir of voices echoing from the distance as the field hands cut the cane and hauled it into the mule-drawn carts. The big sugar mules, 16 hands, pulled these carts. There was a cadence of voices talking, laughing, and singing chants, songs of their elders and old Creole. The work started at daybreak with the sound of the plantation bell and ended well into dusk. Working around the clock, gang shifts, for the duration of the day and duration of the harvest. The longer they could keep it in the ground, the sweeter the cane, but it was always a rush against nature's clock. They had to beat the frost. October 19th, 1868, in the voice of Georges Jacques. This day we was taking time off from the busy sugar cane harvest to head to the courthouse in town to register to vote. I never had been to that courthouse before. Rode there many a time with my masters over the years, but never gone inside. Always stayed outside, tending water for the horses. I'd been in the blacksmith shop most of the last weeks, overseeing Mr. Francois's new blacksmith. He had loads of sugarcane knives to sharpen and was having trouble with the old sharpening wheel I'd built a while back. Money was tight for everyone now. Instead of getting new supplies from the city, I had to show him how to reforge some of the tools we had, some on their last leg, but I thought we could get them through this year's harvest. On this day, I got up very early, before late daylight, to hitch up the large American horses to the carriage, checking the wheels and harnesses. While stepping into the stable, I took a bit to see my mare, Liberté, a 9-year-old sorrel saddle horse. Her coloring was like the red, red dirt in the northern parts of the state. She had markings of a wide stripe of white down her face to her nose, 4 white feet with a white star in her chest. Her mane was very wavy, just like her tail. An easy ride, she was sweet-tempered but gentle. My master, Sir Jean-Baptiste d'Alcour, gave her to me when I became free from President Abraham Lincoln. Her name before was Miss Lily. She was the horse his children learned on. She was like no other mare. I talked to her like a person. I'm always afraid she'll start talking right back, because she listens so closely, moving her ears and nuzzles me as I hold her head. I took the time to groom her a bit And my mind took me thinking back to days leading up to today. It's 1868, just a few years past the end of the rebellion between the South and the North. Union soldiers were still in the city of New Orleans, keeping the peace, where violence and bloodshed broke out since 1866. Although the war ended, the differences between those disagreeing was still going on. There's word that chaotic hostility was spreading all over Louisiana, like a bad yellow fever epidemic. Some killed mercilessly. Thinking back to the days when the wars started, I remember when the men in the state first agreed to be a part of the war with the other states in the South. I was in New Orleans with my master, Sir Dalcour. We went to the city to take care of some business at the city property he had in the quarter. When we stepped off the steamboat, there was a huge crowd of people all along the waterfront and the streets. Women and children, a military band, and soldiers in beautiful uniforms with gold buttons that were shining from the sun. We worked our way into the city around the crowds. As we got closer, my master noticed many of the merchants he did business with. We then saw a flag my master read as Washington Artillery. We stood there for a bit. Each soldier, one by one, got on the train. The crowd was so hopeful for an immediate victory. Boarding the train with all the soldiers was a little Frenchman with a fox in his arms. My master recognized him as the chef at Antoine's. The crowd was giving them gifts as they paraded down Canal Street, some very lavish. They were going to war in fine style. My master told me that they were a Confederate Union going off to war. I couldn't help but wonder what would happen if they were victorious. Would our lives as slaves be like without the rest of the nation? Could we leave and go north? But living here was all we know. Speaking Creole, not American. Back in the country in our place, there were still arguments going on today between those for the Confederacy and some loyal to the Union. The coloreds, called gens de color libre, free people of color, were for the Union, knowing that with our freedom, the slaves, they'd get privileges too. During the war, we had some skirmishes in the area. A large Union camp and hospital were set up at the old Chadwick place, so they could be positioned closer to the Vicksburg, pulled it off the routes along the Mississippi. Around here, we have lots of rivers and canals, some very big, some very small channels, some cutoffs before she changed her course long ago, all because of that Mississippi River and her meandering way past the times when it was just the Indians living around here. This whole place looked very different before the war. The Confederates came through here early on. They were working on the fortification across the river at Port Hudson. They'd come by the plantations to get supplies, food, tools, killing hogs on the spot. Then as the war pressed on, the Union came in closer and set up their camps. They did a lot of raiding of people's property, even taking down complete houses, kitchens, barns. They took full cribs of fresh corn on the shuck, killing hogs, loading chickens, ducks, and geese, often wagons, and driving cattle to their camps. They took down acres and acres of fences, burning some to the ground and using some for firewood. We'd see them come in troops, loading up the people's carts, and just buggies were filled. They'd come in the daytime, not secretly. Sometimes they'd camp a few days on the people's properties during these raids. That camp was up there until the water came. Soldiers seemed to leave after Vicksburg, and then Port Hudson fell, and then the flooding came. Sir Dalcour let me work during the war, earning what I could, selling some of the corn harvest and helping with people's horses, shoeing horses. Not a lot of work, but earning my way. I was still a slave because the laws wouldn't let him give me my freedom. He gave me the little cabin and the property nearby and some acres of cultivated land where I had some field hands working. He said to me he wanted to give me something so my kin could have something after I was gone. Our crop was good. We had a load of corn in all the cribs. One day, whilst I was in the blacksmith shop helping my apprentice, a Confederate cavalry came by demanding I shoe their horses. I'll never forget that old one-armed colonel. I told him I needed to get permission from my master. I went over and asked Mr. Sir John Baptiste, and he flat out said no. He wasn't helping the Confederates. I went back to the shop and told the colonel. He reached across with his one good arm to grab his sword out of the scabbard, but he didn't pull it out. He motioned a signal to his men and looked back at me and said, "I'm going to stretch your neck, old man." They all turned and rode off. One soldier dropped his revolver, not sure he knew that he had dropped it. I picked it up and put it in the trunk in my blacksmith shop. It was a Lamat revolver. During the war, Mr. John Baptiste Delcour's wife and young children were in Paris. They went there about 5 years before the war started, after they sold the big place on the other side of the river. He said that the days were coming for slavery, and that we'd be earning money to do the same work. He learned and feared that there would be trouble, a war, so he wanted his family to go to France, where other colors were visiting and living for the time. The Mrs. Francoise took the children to go there for school and to study the arts. Their little boy, Auguste, was always painting, as long as I can remember. He'd have his relatives sit for portraits, or paint the countryside, or whatever he could. It was going to give him a chance to paint or study with what they told me were the masters. I don't think that meant plantation owners with slaves like it does in this country. It was something about important painters in Europe. My great-granddaughter, Pelagie, went with him to watch over the children. Mr. Francois was older, so he stayed back with his daddy to tend to all the sugar planting places they still had. During the war, the people were being all pretty quiet about how they felt about the war and who they were loyal to. The colored people had no vote or say even before the war and were generally for the Union, or so they'd say. At first, the colored planters got together and did some drilling and marching. I wasn't sure why it stopped until my master told me that they went to the Confederate officials wanting to help with the war, and they still didn't give them their rights, just as it was before. So they quit those home guard troops, came back, and ran their plantations and protected their families. The Confederates were conscripting men. Some would go with them and then desert, looking for safety with the Federals who would put their camps nearby. Most of the prominent white men were for the Confederates and served in the various units. A few of the rich white families were for the Union and helping them out. Having voted against Louisiana joining the war, proud of what President Lincoln was doing. There were some taken as prisoners throughout the war, both the Confederates and the Union camps, but all were released. They took the Catholic priest once after he was serving Mass and some of the free colored men that there were with him. I think they came back about a month after. The priest was blessing the flags of the Confederate troops before they left. The Union officers didn't like that. That priest's slaves told me once at the landing, when we were shipping goods to the city, that priest was still very ill from the treatment there. The water was getting bad with all the mess. My master, Sir John Baptiste, told all of us to stay with him, when we'd be free from the war, since the Confederates were going to get whipped. Many of the masters were telling their slaves that. Some slaves ran away to the Union camps, but most came back. Some men fought, and some were servants to the officers. We were told that after the Union wins, we'd all have a better life with new laws and privileges. Today, we were going for one of those privileges, to register to vote. I was a little nervous, not sure what to expect. My kin were all over this place, mostly girls. My great-grandson, he'll be there at the courthouse tomorrow, too, but I don't think I'll see him, because he's coming over from the north part of this place. Mr. Francois said we're to come in order from where we live, something about districts for voting. Suddenly, my thoughts were interrupted by the storm brewing ahead. Sun was shining in one part, clouds forming overhead, thunder striking. The wind started to blow hard, and the pecans from the old tree by the stable started falling, dropping on the roof of the stable. Tap, tap. Happen. Sheets of rain came down. As quick as it came, it stopped and left a deafening, eerie silence. Like she knew what I was thinking, Liberté dropped her head onto my shoulder as if to tell me everything would be fine. Then all of a sudden, she whinnied a little bit, lifted her front right leg, and put it down. I don't know what she was saying, but she always made me feel better. I needed to get, so I put her in the pasture and went on over to the carriage house. I went to see the hitching of the horses. The driver was a young, dark-skinned boy whose mom and sister, at the time slaves, were killed while trying to rush to the federal side. He was left behind, now orphaned, taken in by the Dalcour family. Mr. Francois was trying him in a lot of work. Driver for the carriage seemed to suit him best. We rode the carriage up to the house. I went in to see on Sir Francois to see if he was ready. In the parlor was the widow Francois Dalcour. She'd been so frail since the death of her husband, Sir Dalcour, left with three children. He died while they were in France. Word slow to get to her. As soon as she heard, they all returned. Her son Francois was taken up where his daddy left. Still in mourning, she'd sit quietly at times and rock in that very rocker my little Pelagie sat on, holding a bag of gold when the Federals visited the place during the war. Little Pelagie happened to be at the house alone at the time, tatting, while Sir John Baptiste and Sir Francois and the other slaves were out by the riverfront tending to a levee break. The widow Dalcour was a very beautiful lady, delicate features, slight build, who spoke only Creole and Parisian French and loved music. American was never spoken in that house or with any of the other people in the neighboring area. I knew a little American from some of the other slaves I was around in my lifetime in the country, those brought here from the East with their masters. Miss Julie Mattie walked into the parlor and handed me a wrapped package. Pelagie had been teaching her tatting and sewing. She said she made me a fine shirt for today. Take it with you and change it with a Simone's place. Pelagie came in the room just at that moment to hand me some freshly ironed pants and my boots shining like I'd never seen. Mr. Francois came down the stairs with his satchel ready to go, handing me a pair of suspenders of his daddy's, saying he knew his daddy would have wanted me to have them. He kissed his mama and sister, told him he'd be back in a few days. The widow Dalcour got up from the rocking chair in the parlor and followed us to the front gallery, standing there, waving us on as we left for the road. She yelled for me to take care of her son. I promised her back with a wave. We were all hoping we'd have no trouble going into town to register. There were still some important people in this place that weren't happy about how the war ended, and now the new laws. Mr. Francois told me to pack some guns in the carriage just in case. I put my Lamat revolver under the seat. It seems the violence was going to begin in our place, too. Now with a new government, freedom laws, and men of color in political office for Louisiana. There was some kind of a revolt brewing up. You could sense the tension between the Republican and Democrats and the office holders. Some previous masters had begun to turn on their old slaves, those who were embracing the chance for earning opportunity and civil rights for them and their families. Elections had changed now, with men of color were allowed to participate. In New Orleans, the large merchant group was against the Republicans and their laws. I thought we'd see more bloodshed now than when the war was going on around here. Like me, many were not able to read or write. I knew a number of words and phrases, could recognize them more like pictures in my mind, but never had the need to write. I stored everything in my head. I'd been around enough to hear and learn about the activities and goings-on from the masters, their families, and their friends. We didn't speak anything but Creole together. Some new people from other parts of the world or the country would speak English or other languages, but they soon spoke Creole, too. It was going to be a two-day ride. Now on our way, we didn't get very far down the road when suddenly we heard a tone of horses' freshly shotted hooves on the solid dirt road in the distance as we followed the riverfront. Vigilantes were following our buggy, paces behind. It sounded like a cadence of cavalry, like those we heard passing through this place during the war. Not a word was spoken from the posse behind. Periodically, a frightening silence would arise. They would stop their horses at the same time, give us a little time to get ahead, and then they'd proceed to follow. This went on the whole day. When we arrived at Widow Simone's place, the daylights were passing. Her lamps outside were lit brightly, and we could smell the aroma of her kitchen. Windows opened with a cool air blowing through her house from the back to the front gallery. The sun was setting on the river, its reflection passing through a prism of light from crystal goblets on her sideboard. A waft of a delicious something was emanating from her back kitchen. Her house servants, once her slaves, carried in a large pot of fricassee and put it in a bowl on the table. The table was set as I'd seen it in all my master's houses when they entertained. I'd never eaten in the big house. The posse seemed to have camped down for the night. We were ready to face them again in the morning, but for now we'd enjoy our stay at Widow Simone's place and finish our ride to town early in the morning. I slept in the overseer's place, a small house near the main. I couldn't sleep. It seemed like my life was passing before me. Tuesday, October 20th, 1868. Early morning, we got back on the carriage and continued our journey. Widow Simone's cook gave us some warm bread and a napkin with some fruit. We were all dressed up this day. We checked our guns and ammunition to be sure they were still there. I had my revolver by my side. Sir Francois laid the others in the carriage with him, hoping it wouldn't come to nothing, but we were ready. We were getting closer to town. The courthouse was coming close in sight. Suddenly, the posse gained on us and pulled their horses right in front of ours. One of our lead American horses reared up a bit, and the young driver calmed him down. I told him to pull the reins a bit to signal the horses to halt. The horses obeyed, but with caution. They felt something was going to be bad. A man shouted for me to get off the carriage. I saw at the side of my eye a glint of brass on a sword with three carved initials. I then looked up and saw the one-armed Confederate colonel. He pulled out of formation and rode his horse right by my side. He yanked his sword out of its scabbard, looked like the same one I'd seen before. The colonel shouted at me and told us to get off the carriage. I could hear Sir Francois telling him to stay calm in the back. Furious that we did nothing, the colonel pulled his horse right by where I was sitting, next to the young driver, and shouted at me, "Old man, turn this carriage back and go back to the quarters where you belong. This is no place for the likes of you." He pointed the tip of his sword right at the center of my neck. Remembering I had that revolver beside me, I immediately picked it up, thinking I had nothing to lose, and pointing it right at his face. I cocked the revolver and was going to fire if I had to. I couldn't miss at that close of a range. Suddenly, clouds moved overhead. Thunder struck. The wind blew hard. Another quick storm was moving in. Just around us. The colonel's horse got skittish, reared up a few times, misstepped, and started back and straight up. The colonel turned his horse, pulled her hard, slapped her sides with the reins. He rode off yelling to me, "Old man, I'm going to stretch your neck yet. This isn't the end of this." A little shaken, we all kind of continued on, and the storm turned quiet. The posse dispersed. Sir Francois told us not to look back, so we didn't know which way they went. We could hear them scatter, each going a different direction. We wondered if they were going to be hiding for us, waiting for us when we headed back. We arrived at the courthouse and pulled up to tie the horses. That skirmish with the colonel and the posse delayed us. We arrived close to the end of the day. The sun was moving around the river. When we arrived, many men were filing out of the courthouse. For a moment, no one moved. We didn't even get off the carriage yet. Then Mr. Francois outstretched his hand to gently assist me off the carriage with a long step to the ground. Although still quite spry and in good physical shape, they tell me I'm 100, I accepted his hand quietly. "Merci, Sir Francois." Emotion came over me. My eyes started to fill with tears. As we walked nearer to the door, I removed my tattered straw hat. She'd been with me through a lot in life. I wore her for luck that day. Turning a bit, I caught my reflection in the glass. Before me was an elder man, whose tight curled hair had become almost white, my beard speckled with gray, my skin had darkened from a lifetime in the sun, and the age of wrinkles set in at the corner of my dark brown eyes, now with a thin blue rim. I felt 50 years younger with my fine new shirt, suspenders, my well-shined boots and pressed pants. I don't think I was dressed in such finery before. Each step into the courthouse, I felt like I replayed every day of my life, a long life a slave, now free with privileges, just like that of my master, Sir Dalcour, told me. Down the hall, we reached a door. Sir Francois opened it for me. We walked into a grand room, the office of the clerk of court for the parish. On a table was a register, an inkwell, and a dip pen lying beside a large book. Somehow I ended up being the last to sit, to swear in and to make my mark. I could see others sign their name. I never did learn to write. Sir Moreau, the clerk of court, started to give me his hand a shake, as he did with each of the men before him. Suddenly he stopped. He looked down, picked up the worn wooden-handled dip pen with the almost flattened gold tip from the table. Reaching into a breast pocket of his jacket, he got his handkerchief and wrapped it around the pen, wiping off the ink. He handed me the pen and the handkerchief and said, "Jean-Jacques, you have proven to all of us today that anything is possible." Tears again began to fill up in my eyes. For the first time in my life, I wasn't noticing what was going around me, only what I was experiencing. I quickly smiled and we shook hands warmly. He held onto my hand with both of his hands for what seemed to be forever. Our eyes met in kindness. At that moment, I wondered that this must be what it is like to be a wealthy man. We got back in the carriage and began our journey back. We didn't speak a word at first. The ride home, I began to think about so many thoughts about the past. I'm not sure what Sir Francois was thinking about. Maybe about his daddy, who had died just a year earlier, wishing he had been there with him. Almost 150 years of history had passed since my first ancestor was brought to this place, then the new colony of France. Having never learned to write, I proudly made my mark today and thought of all the old people before me. Now all those after me can get on with a new start. Holding tightly onto that dip pen, my thoughts continued. I began to remember all the stories my mama told me. When she was dying, she made me promise I would keep telling the stories to all the young ones, all the way back to my grandfather, who was brought on the first slave ship from Gambia along the Senegal River to the Louisiana colony. Sitting next to me was the son of my last master, who too was a Creole, always free, but had no rights to vote or to go against a white man in court or to marry a white woman or other things like that. His daddy was one of the wealthiest men in the South and used to own hundreds of slaves on his sugar plantations and had no privileges. President Abraham Lincoln gave me my freedom. You know, I guess he gave Sir Francois and his family their freedom too. Today we shared equal rights of freedom, privilege, together. The day quickly turned to night as we rode back to the Simone place. This evening, the moon was brighter than ever as it shone over the water. The bell at the church was ringing in the distance, with 8 deep-toned chimes just singing with the beats of my heart, echoing into the early night. When we arrived, Widow Simone had a pot of gumbo warming on the back stove. New Orleans, October 20th, 1960. Nanan was tiring. We'd been listening to her talk for 4 hours over the last 3 days. She persisted, saying it was time to tell us the whole story. She didn't want this history to die with her. The next day, she sat quietly in her wingback chair all day. She carried an extraordinary aura of inner peace, an uncanny sparkle in her eyes, and gazed lovingly at me. Somehow I knew that she was leaving us soon. Creoles express so much with their eyes. 2 days later, Nanan passed away peacefully in her sleep. Her wonderful dark brown eyes, encircled with blue rims, closed for the last time that fall. She left me with a gift greater than any material wealth. Somehow, although I was deeply saddened by her leaving us, I felt empowered and liberated by the truth. I never got the chance to tell her about that little girl on the bus with her grandmother. Passing the baton of our family history illuminated a profound answer to why they get the best seat on the bus. Thank you.
Let me tell you.
In front of each of you, that's a silicone bracelet that says anything is possible. The website for the project address is on the back. And these glow-in-the-dark. Is this on? Okay. In front of each of you is a silicone bracelet. The message is anything is possible. They glow in the dark. And each one of us carries that flicker of light to make a change.
The best you'll ever be is the local star at the local bar. But I went and did it anyway. Family helping all the way.
Does anyone have any questions?
Now I'm here today, five records later. So you can hear me say no.
I think this is very inspiring.
You can't be.
I love to be read to. I love the story.
Anything you want to be.
Just kind of puts you there.
Don't be deceived.
And actually looking for this to be either a series or a film too as well. So just a great, since he's sort of the quintessential observer as a character, it's a great way to sort of tell our history, Louisiana history, you know, starting from the beginning to that. And like I said, when I saw, this was a nonfiction project, and when I saw that register in person, and you open it up, and you know, we were kind of looking at names, and the first thing you do is you look for your own family. Oh, he signed, and oh, there he is, and look how everybody is together. And as like children, we thought, well, wonder who's the oldest? You know, you start to run your finger down the page, and you see this gentleman was 100 years old, and that just completely inspired the whole thing, and it's definitely one of these people that can really tell our story from all perspective. So I'll keep you all posted. You'll know sort of as the project sort of progresses, but I really appreciate getting to unveil it with you all here today, and just so you know, what's coming ahead.
JU, and we are just blessed to be a part of this and to have you here today. Also, now these were the records right after the war, mm-hmm. and just during Reconstruction, and then we all know that we lost that right. So these records are interesting in that they were like some of the first. I mean,
and with this, in the sense you get, and this is in, you know, obviously in every parish, you know, since it was the 1867 legislation that gave the right to vote, it, when you open the pages, you just get that sense, and it's kind of where you get to kind of lock that sense of hope and time, you know, that they see that the way they all felt. Of course, we all know kind of today how history played out. But they're available in all the courthouses. And what we did in Pointe Coupe is when I found that the Creole West Productions helped preserve that record. But so that's there, you know, in the parish to take a look. It does take us into the time when we know when we lost the rights and takes you through the whole process. There's when I talk about sort of the ordinary people that were our heroes and heroines, we go through a lot of the early cases, the first cases to fight for civil rights, one of which was, you know, sort of formed on this one character, the widow Francoise, that sued the steamboat Governor Allen for being discriminated against. They put her in steerage coming up to Pointe Coupe. was actually the first case before Plessy v. Ferguson, and it kind of set the precedence for that separate, you know, but equal kind of doctrine. So it's interesting, kind of you get into these cases, and through Georges Jacques, since he's been sort of all over and he's been owned by all these people, he sees all this happen to everybody else. And so a lot of that will be illuminated, and you'll get into that in detail, and it kind of pulls us up to the 1890s when a lot of the families started moving, you know, from the country to the city, and then from there onward, you know, where all of us are Californian and Colorado, and I'm spread all over the country now. So, but you get that sense sort of that whole progress.